Okay, this is going to be video number 4, palliative hospice care. Now, at the end of this video or sometime today, you're going to be going back on Blackboard for discussion question number 3. Explain the different members of the hospice team and is it best for someone who is terminal to be on hospice or not to be on hospice? Kind of share your thoughts basically with the class on that question. So, now remember, when we're talking about hospice, when we're talking about palliative care, it works toward the management of symptoms, not toward the cure of a disease. Now, they're going to deal. There was a change in hospice, and it wasn't all that long ago. Because for a person to go on hospice, especially with Medicare, Medicaid, private insurance companies, it takes 2 doctors to basically certify that individual, that they are terminal. And when I first went into hospice a long time ago, the piece of paper said that the person had 6 months or less to live. That was what the two physicians had to sign. Well, what happens if the patient lives 6 months and a couple days? Discharge, okay? Well, there's been a change in the wording of this certification documentation, and most hospices really are in favor of this. And instead of saying a cold, hard, this person has 6 months to live, it has this in it. To the best of my ability, if the disease runs its natural course, this patient has 6 months or less to live. So there's now 2 statements in there that weren't there before. One, to the best of my ability, the best of my knowledge, okay? And 2, if the disease runs its natural course. One of the things that I've always noticed with hospice is that when a patient first comes on hospice, and this could be 1 week or maybe a few weeks, they will show signs of improvement. They will. And part of the reason why is they've got an RN coming in and helping them with their meds. You'd be amazed about how many people do not take their medicines correctly. They're cracking them in half, they're taking it every other day, trying to stretch out those medicine dollars. And, because see, one of the things that hospice is responsible for paying for is all the medications that are related to the terminal illness. Now, in the hospice that I was with, we just paid for all their meds. Because how could you sometimes differentiate a medication that was related or not related to the terminal illness? I mean, yeah, I guess if the neighbor's dog comes in and bites them in the leg, they get an infection. Yeah, that might not be related to the terminal illness, but yet still, if they didn't have the terminal illness, would they be in the bed and not able to kick at the dog or to run or to throw something at them where they wouldn't have gotten bit? So how we could never separate, that. So we just basically paid for all the meds. But that is one of the things hospice does, is pay for the meds that are related to the terminal illness. And then equipment in the home. If a hospital bed was needed, oxygen that was basically needed, a special mattress, a special wheelchair, special things that were needed for this individual for comfort because of the terminal illness was doing to them. So you get a patient that didn't have all this, the RN support, the medications now that are being regulated correctly, they're taking them correctly, getting the right therapeutic dose, and now they have equipment and adaptive equipment to help them. So it's not that unusual to see patients get better after an admission to a hospice. Plus, of course, not only do they have the RN, they've got the hospice aide, they have the social worker, and they have the chaplain and possibly a volunteer. So now this whole social networking, you know, to maybe before they were isolated and alone and scared, well, now all of a sudden they have friends. And even beyond that, they have family. One of the doctors in Butler described hospice to me this way, and it's always stuck with me. The patient is walking down a path in which the direction of that path cannot be changed. And the family is gathered up around them, walking with them. And they're, like I said, they're walking down this path in which the direction of the path cannot change. And that's obviously they're walking toward the path is the journey of life, and they're walking toward, you know, their death. And what hospice does is he said, would gather up all around the patient, the family, and walk with them. And then when the patient came to the spot, the end of the path in which they and they alone could take the last step, which would be their death, the family turns around and journeys back the same path that they took. But now the hospice stays with the family and stays gathered around the family and walks with them back on this journey. Hospice just journeys with a person, you know, and with their family as they are taking this journey, like I said, journey of life, you know, that is going to end in their passing. So the team members, okay, the basic team members are registered nurse, licensed practical nurse, okay. They're going to be going to the house and looking for signs and symptoms that are distressing that person for that day. Pain, nausea, vomiting, restlessness, dyspnea, shortness of breath, air hunger, whatever. You know, what is bothering this person? Getting hold of the physician and then working out an intervention, working out a care plan. You know, the problem is stated, now let's work toward a goal, let's build the interventions to get from point A to point B in our care plan. Point A is problem, point B is goal reached. So the interventions are how we get from A to B. So work on that. So you're going to have your RNs and LPNs coming in for visits for that. You're going to have your home health aide, your hospice aide coming in. They're part of the team. They're the eyes and ears of the RNs and LPNs because they're there a lot of times on days that they're, you know, the home health aide, the hospice aide is there on days that the licensed professional nurse is not there. So they're going to be looking for other things too, similar things that are basically distressing this person, and then getting a hold of the RN case manager for a plan to take care of this. They're going to be helping them with their bath, helping them with even chores around the house, because hospice is about relief. And sometimes the relief may be physical, but the relief may just be more environmental. You know, so they may be washing clothes for them, doing some light laundry, doing some dishes, maybe some housework, maybe even possibly running some errands for them. You know, the caregiver doesn't want to leave the bedside, the husband of his wife, but there's some bills that have to be paid or something like that. The home health aide, the hospice aide can basically do that. Run those type of things, because it's all about supporting the family. And if that's what they need at the time, then that's what is basically the support that's basically given. So they'll come in with mostly the bathing is the majority of what they do, but then they do these other things too. The social worker and chaplain, or now called spiritual care coordinator, will come in and deal with emotional issues, the social worker with issues of help for financial, with counsel, with advice, with helping with grieving and mourning and things that are in the social, psychological realm, the emotional realm. They will come in and offer services for that pain. then the spiritual care coordinator, of course, is going to come in the spiritual level and offer support. Not preaching a particular religion or denomination or anything like that, but offering a support to people, offering a hope and a help to people. So those are your paid, I guess you could call it, your paid hospice team members. The nurses are an LPN, the aides, home health aide, hospice aide, social worker, spiritual care coordinator, okay? Now, you also have a bereavement coordinator in hospices. Now, the bereavement coordinator may make a visit before the person dies just to introduce themselves to the family, but their focus of service is going to be to the family of the patient after they have died. And a lot of your hospices, now one of the things that Medicare does mandate is 13 months of follow-up. And this is the job of the bereavement coordinator, 13 months of following up with the family through cards, letters, and all important, those visits to them, scheduled visits of just going, checking on them, how they're doing. And I've had some situations where sometimes you just follow your gut instinct. Stress and loss can do a lot to a person. You know that, especially with the heart and cardiac. There was one man, 6 months after his wife had passed away, I walked in. I was just in the area of the county, just had a feeling I needed to go visit him. Usually I didn't make on-schedule visits, but this is the one time I thought I needed to. I walk in the middle of a heart attack. The stress of the loss had caused that much of cardiac issues for him that he was right in the middle of the heart attack when I walked in. And that's part of the job of the bereavement coordinator, to help people, because they are going to have issues and they need somebody basically there to hold them up. Another huge valuable member of the hospice team is the volunteer. Now, this is a non-paid. And it's just like what the term says, volunteer, where they go to the person's house and just, for a lack of a better word, just love on them. We've had our volunteers do different things, from everything to sit and read and hold a person's hand, to mow their lawn, to fix their roof, to bring their children out fishing. And that was a good diversional activity for the children, you know, to get them out fishing. We've had volunteers do people's taxes for them. Just a whole number of different things that these volunteers did, and they play a huge role. There is a massive role that they basically play for these folks, because they become a friend. They become a listening ear, a supportive ear for them. So a lot of times they are really appreciated. It takes, the hospice team is a big team, because there's a lot of changes that are going on with the death and dying process. And it's almost like all hands on deck to a certain amount, to where, you know, there's a number of watchful eyes, because even the social worker and the chaplain are watching for things. When they're making their visit in their area, they're still aware of the physical. And if the RN case manager needs to be called because the pain is up, or the nausea or constipation or any kind of an issue there. So it takes a lot. So when we talk about hospice, it's of course, you know, ordered by the physician for a person who basically has 6 months or less to live. But now with the newer terminology, to the best of my ability, if the disease runs its natural course, the person has 6 months or less to live. The hospice can see the person in in and wherever they call home, hospital, nursing care facility, private home. Now the hospice will use a holistic approach. And a lot of times they will use alternatives in addition to traditional care. Colors, smells that are very relaxing, music therapy, touch and massage, things that are very, very relaxing. There's a gentleman here in Paola that's a volunteer for one of the hospices. I've never met him, but what I've heard is he plays the harp, and he'll go to the hospice patient's home that's breathing real fast, like that, and he will start playing his harp to match their breathing. But then all of a sudden he'll start slowing his harp down, and in several different times, the pattern, the breathing pattern of the patient will now match his slower rhythm on the harp and will slow their breathing process down where they were panting before. So they will use traditional and non-traditional. Like I said, smells, even administration of meds, to compounding, where the person can't swallow anymore, they'll have a pharmacy that compounds for them, crushes, puts it into a paste, and they'll put the paste on the wrist here to absorb, the ointment of the medicine to absorb through the skin. So it offers medically directed team management care and focuses on the resident, focuses on the family. Offers very compassionate care. I know a lot of hospice nurses that a lot of times they'll get 30, 40 miles out from their office, be late at night, they'll just go sleep in the car because they know in about 2 or 3 hours the family's going to be needing them, and they would be better safety-wise for them even to just stay there and sleep there than try to drive back home, get an hour sleep, then come back. But I've known a lot of hospice nurses that have stayed for their families for this. The emphasis is, of course, on pain and symptom management, offers assistance with psychosocial needs. Of course, that is the medical social worker. Helps families obtain financial counseling and even legal assistance, another job of the social worker. And everybody's looking for pain, looking for signs of pain, and when they see it, to basically immediately treat it. It's important for residents who are dying to have control of their lives as long as they're living, and of course that's what hospice basically achieves for the person. They work with the person through the stages: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance, and just kind of help the person go on. Knowing that everybody doesn't go through these stages all the same or at the same rate, but they're just there for the folks. So this is an overview of the hospice team, working together for the care, the comfort of the patient and the family, and then of course after the person's death, still being there for them for a long period of time, basically helping them, go on, process through this, and then watching, some of the major caregivers that, how are they doing after the death of their loved ones. So that's where we end this one today. Like I said, don't forget discussion board question 3. Let's get out and talk about the different members of hospice, and then let's talk about it. Is it best for somebody who is terminal to have hospice or not have hospice? Thank you.